Praise the Lord for that. So that is God's grace that people in the Old Testament, they don't understand all about that. Now, they also did not understand the fullness of the Spirit and His anointing. And His anointing. In the Old Testament, only selected people were indwelt by the Holy Spirit, like the kings, the prophets, not everyone. But in the New Testament, hey, your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. They don't understand about anointing. So that when you're singing, you're preaching, you can feel something within you and the hairs of your body are still standing up. That is the feeling of being anointed. And they do not understand that. They don't dwell and they didn't have that anointing. Because they are in the Old Testament. Salvation is not for them, but for the New Testament people. So they don't understand about the gifts of the Holy Spirit, the fruit of the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, and all those things. Now in Mark 16:17, they don't understand the power that Jesus has given them, that they can be demons drivers in Matthew 16:17. That they are tongue speakers, that they are snake pickers and they will not die, that they are sick healers and they can pray for the sick, and that they are poison survivors and all those things. They don't understand that. It's only us. The Lord has given us authority and power to do that. The sad thing is, we are not exercising those power and authority that the Lord is giving us. But if you have faith in the Lord to do that, then that is going to happen. So they don't understand about the blood of Jesus. All they knew is the blood of the animals, sacrificing the best animal that they have, the lamb or the sheep or whatever they have, and then drain the blood and then offering it to the tabernacle, and that's it. They didn't know that there is more precious than the blood of the animal, and that is the blood of Jesus. They had no understanding that the blood of the Lamb will be crucified on the cross, and it will be drained on the cross, poured out on the cross once and for all for the remission or forgiveness of our sins. They don't understand the name Jesus and His power and His authority. They don't know that. All they know is there's a coming Messiah. There's a coming Emmanuel. But they don't know that the name Jesus carries all the power and the authority of the Father, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. They didn't know that the name of Jesus can drive out demons, that the name of Jesus, sickness can be healed, that the name of Jesus, impossible things can be found possible. Because that is our team, J-E-S-U-S, so that the wealth and the inheritance in heaven will be open for us as if we know the team, J-E-S-U-S. And you will have the team if you are a born-again Christian. All right? Amen. Are you still there? You're so quiet. I'm the only one who's noisy in here. Okay. Now, they try to find out about the time in the era in verse 11 regarding the sufferings and glorification of the Messiah. They were trying to look for someone who would be crucified, who would be suffering all these things. No one was. And so they didn't know who the Messiah was. Now, in the translation, in the message, the translation was, they clamored to know who and when, who is going to be the Messiah, when is this going to happen? And they had no full knowledge of the Messiah even until now. They didn't know that the Messiah is already about to come for the second time, and they're still waiting for the first coming, crying before the wailing wall, crying and praying that the Messiah will come. They didn't know that He has come already 2,000 years ago, and He is about to come for the second time, because they rejected the Messiah. Because salvation is not for them. They don't understand these things that we are all understanding. Can you get the point? Amen. Raise your hand, clap your hand if you understand what I'm saying. Praise the Lord for that. Alright. Now, all they knew was there would be they were expecting for a strong ruler, a powerful monarch, an influential leader like The President of America, Obama, who is the most powerful man on earth, and not just a carpenter. How can a carpenter be the Messiah? How can... He's like a poor. He doesn't even have his own house. So how can he be our Messiah? And then he's just like an ordinary person. He has no education at all. And how can he be the great man, the great ruler of Israel? So salvation doesn't belong to them. If you ask me, well, when they die, where will they go? That's another topic that I don't want to discuss today. All right, now the next is called, you get it. Next one. Yes, the scope of salvation wasn't meant for angels. Amen. Praise the Lord. Because in verse 12 it says there, even the angels are eagerly watching these things to happen. They're just watching. They're excited to watch. So that when Jesus was born and pairs of angels were announcing to the shepherds, to the shepherds, that the Messiah was born. But it doesn't mean that they belong to the salvation. They are not redeemed by the blood of Jesus. Angels are happy for the salvation of men. Angels are not meant to be saved by the blood of Jesus. You know why? Because Jesus became a man, a human being like you and I. He did not become an angel to save the angels. If he did that, he would be saving the demons who would be repenting. And Satan. But he didn't become an angel. He became a human being just like us. So when we repent, hey, I am entitled to salvation because I am a human being saved by the blood of Jesus. And so angels are not included in God's plan of salvation. There was someone, I forgot who asked me that. I think in our Tuesday, yesterday, Wednesday Bible study, what about the demons and all this bad stuff? The angels, fallen angels, will they be saved? Or will they be repenting or something? No, they won't. They won't save. They won't be saved. They won't repent. Because that's how they are. The moment they rebel against God, they Lucifer. That's it. They fell here on earth. That's what they called fallen angels. And that's it. They dictated their own destiny. Praise the Lord. Very much. Okay. Now, the angels were definitely not included in salvation that Jesus had provided because Jesus did not die for them. Jesus only died for us. Okay? Jesus only died for you and I. So they have no power of the blood. They don't need the blood of Jesus. Jesus' blood was shed on the cross for us so that our sins will be washed away. It didn't say in the Bible that the sins of the angels will be washed away. Nothing like that. So only the sin, our sin. So Jesus only died for us, the name of Jesus. So no doubt the angels were amazed on God's plan of salvation. I believe in my heart that when Jesus was about to leave heaven and get down on earth and become Mary's baby, the angels knew that. And then when Jesus was here on earth, of course he wasn't in heaven because he was a human being. So when Jesus was here on earth for 33 years, I am sure the angels missed him, because the Son of God used to be there for eternity from the beginning, and suddenly he's gone because he's here on earth. And so Jesus took a 33-year R&R, not recreation, rest and recreation, but you know the meaning of R&R. He took a 33 years R&R, the redemption and restoration of men. So that was his assignment. Now, in this book by Edwin Lewis Cole, he was saying that there was one time an intensive fasting in his church. And on the 10th day that the church was fasting, Then one guy saw a vision when Jesus went back to heaven and he was met by an angel. And who eagerly asked him, "Master, how did you come on earth?" Okay, so surely the angels missed Jesus for 33 years, no matter how long it is in heaven, but he wasn't there for 33 years. So, "Master, how did you go on earth?" And Jesus said, "Men will be saved." That's the answer of Jesus. And then the angels saw the scars on his hands, feet, and side, and side, and asked, "But how will men know of their salvation? How will people get saved? Those people who were born and born and born afterwards, how will they know their salvation?" And he replied, "I have commissioned my disciples to preach the good news in all the world." "But what if they fail?" the angel said. "But what?" they were doubting. And so Jesus gave us the command to preach the good news to other people so that the next generation people will know about the Lord. Now, if salvation is not for the Old Testament people, not even for David, not even for Abraham, not even for Adam, not even for those Jews and Hebrew people that came out of Egypt, then who is entitled for salvation? Verse 12, the next screen, Miguel. "The scope of salvation was meant for you." Right? Now, let's, in verse 9, can we go there? Verse 9 and 12? Or did I put it in? No. Just go back to verses 9 and 12. Okay, in verse 9, "The reward for trusting Him," meaning those who have given His faith in Jesus, "the reward for trusting Him will be the salvation of your souls." Peter was talking to the people during his time, not to the Old Testament people who were already dead, alright? So he was saying that the reward for trusting Him, your faith in Him, will be the salvation of your soul. So when you have faith in Jesus, you will be saved. And then in verse 12, they were told, the prophets were told, that their messages or their message about the suffering Messiah, about salvation, about all the good things of the Lord, were not for themselves, but for you. Can you say it now, loudly? Salvation is mine. Say it again. Salvation is mine.
Salvation.
Own it. Alright, I want it louder because I couldn't feel that you really like it, you know? Salvation is mine. Alright. Say it and own it. Salvation is mine.
Salvation is mine.
Praise the Lord. The Lord can hear you now. And He's happy. And He's happy. So the reward for our salvation now. Now, you and I are the recipients of salvation, not the Old Testament people. And the full benefits of God's plan of salvation are all intended for Christians. See? All the blessings of God. Now, in verse 12, let me say that again. It was revealed to the prophets, and they realized that salvation wasn't meant for them, but for the believers of Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, hence, when you are saved, here are some of the things that you can do. You can have the ministry of the Holy Spirit in your life as your guide, as your advocate or lawyer, and you can have the gifts and the fruit of the Spirit. And you also have the power and the authority that Jesus has delegated it upon us, so that you can use His name. Anyone who uses the name of Jesus and isn't a Christian, no effect. Nothing will happen. Like the sons of Sheba, driving out the demons, and they were possessed because they were not Christians. And so if you're a Christian, and then you use the name of Jesus, there is an effect because you are a Christian. Right. So you can pray for healing, deliverance from any vices, you know, and all those things, from any sins and all those things. And then you can also enjoy the power of the blood and the name of Jesus. Your sins are washed away. I told you last time, many times already, that in the Old Testament, their sins were only covered by the blood of the animals. But in the New Testament, our sins are not covered. They are washed away. So that when the lid is taken out, the Father doesn't say, I don't see any sin at all. Because the blood of Jesus is like the cleansing power, like Tide or Breeze in the Philippines. That's the detergent. What do we have here?
Ajax.
Ajax. Ajax? Come on. Oh, I don't use Ajax for washing my clothes. Praise the Lord. But you know what I mean there? That the Father doesn't see anything because the blood of the Lord has already cleansed our sin. Praise the Lord. And then we also have the mind of Christ. See that? We have the mind of Christ. Not only your mind, but the mind of Christ is given to you so that you understand things. Things about God, things about church, things about the Bible. So that when you read the Bible through the help of the Holy Spirit, you are able to understand, oh, this is why I understand God's plan for me. Because this verse relates to that verse and to this passage and to that passage. In other words, we can see the Bible in its entirety, the whole view, the whole from Genesis to Revelation, we can see it, understand it, because we are saved. Salvation is ours. Saved again, salvation is mine.
Salvation is mine.
One more time, stronger.
Salvation.
One more time.
Salvation is mine.
Pastor, every now, praise the Lord. Let's all stand up and sing a song, Amazing Grace. Just the first part.